two of our majors in accuracy in corporate restructuring lecture series. So in the first part, we introduced the concept of majors. It also described the various types of majors and the reasons why entities enter into major transactions. So now we are going to discuss issues around the terms of a major. So the first key question is around determining the financing option for the acquirer. Are we going to finance the major via cash, or are we going to issue shares in our own company to finance the acquisition? Then the second question would be, okay, we've decided to acquire the company, the target company. How much should we pay for the equity in the target company? Which then brings into play the valuation of the target entity. So we first of all discuss acquisition financed by cash. So obviously the first key question is, the model here is I want to pay cash. How much should I pay? So it means I need to be able to value the target company. And which brings us to the models you would have done under your valuations. You can either use the free cash flow valuation, dividend discount model, pricing earnings ratio. And I believe at this stage, we've now mastered these valuation techniques. But within the context of mergers and acquisitions, what additional factors do you need to consider? So if I apply the dividend growth model, the question is, how do I incorporate synergic benefits that may arise from an acquisition or a merger? So if a dividend growth model, you can adjust either the dividend itself or you can adjust the growth rate to take into account the synergic benefits. Then if you are looking at the free cash flow valuation method, it can give you the mean and maximum values. What do you mean by this? So the minimum price is equivalent to the worth of a target company as a standalone entity. So say if we're going to value it separately, how much is it worth? The maximum value is not the current value of the target company plus any synergic benefits. So let's now take this into the context of the buyer and the seller. When you are buying, we are worried about the maximum price that you should pay because your risk is overpaying. So the maximum price is normally calculated within the context of the buyer. What is the maximum price I need to pay? Then if you are looking at the seller's risk is, I'm going to be underpaid. So the minimum price is now from the seller's perspective. How much at a minimum should I get if I sell my shareholding in the target entity? So let's see how all this works. Acquisition financed by share issue. So I said either cash or share issue. So share issue, how does it work? Let's look at an example about company A and company B. Company A wants to buy shares in company B or want to acquire company B. So company B already has existing shareholders. So company A can say, B shareholders, I'm going to give you shares in company A in exchange for your shares in company B. Now the question is, which ratios do we use for the exchange? Which then gives us what we call the exchange ratio, which is the number of shares in the acquiring company to be exchanged for one share in the target company. But then we've got a number of factors affecting the exchange ratio. The main one being the relative earnings per share. So how does the relative earnings, the exchange ratio affect the relative earnings per share? So if company A and B can have differing price earnings ratio, and if they enter into this in actual finance by shares, there might be dilutive effect to the earnings per share ratio, which neither company would want. So how do you address the risk of the dilutive effect? We address by how we then determine the exchange ratio. So to avoid dilution, the exchange ratio will then be calculated as the earnings per share of the target company divided by the earnings per share of the acquirer. So it means when they then exchange shares using this ratio, both companies will suffer dilution to their earnings per share. And how then do we use the exchange ratio to calculate the number of shares to be issued? We are now saying exchange ratio multiplied by the number of shares in the target company. Now, looking at earnings per share and snitch, how do these things, how are they taken into account? So if we say the exchange ratio is equal to earnings per share of target company divided by earnings per share of the acquiring company. But that is before we took into account any synergic benefits. Now we are introducing synergic benefit and how it affects the exchange ratio. So the maximum, we said, exchange ratio is what the acquiring company should be willing to offer without suffering any dilution in its earnings per share. And with this formula, so ER maximum, remember, we are looking at it from the perspective of the buying company. And we are taking into account the synergic benefits. And we are saying it's earnings per share of the target company divided by earnings per share of the acquiring company plus the synergic earnings. So we are saying if we combine with this business, what additional earnings are we expecting to earn just from that relationship? That's what we are calling SE. Divided by EPSS, earnings per share of the acquiring company, multiplied by the number of shares of the target company prior to the merger. So by applying this formula, you should be able to get your exchange ratio. So within the context of the exam, you need to ask yourself, do I have the information to be able to apply this formula? And what am I trying to do? I only use the way, number one, the acquisition is going to be financed by a share exchange. Two, do I have the information in the case to be able to apply this formula? Critical questions before you start running around doing this calculation. Then on the flip side, minimum exchange ratio. At a minimum, what should the target company accept without experiencing a dilution in its earnings per share? So the formula is a bit similar, but just twist it around. So earnings per share of the target company times number of acquiring company share price prior to merger divided by merger earnings plus earnings per share of the acquiring company times number of shares of acquiring company. So when do you use this formula? When you want to calculate the minimum price. Or the required simply says, can you determine the minimum price that the seller should be willing to accept? You need to apply this formula. The previous maximum, maybe the required say, can you determine the maximum price that the buyers should offer for the acquisition? Not to say they are used interchangeably. You need to look at the differing circumstances. Then, still developing on exchange ratios, you can also calculate this based on market values. So, market values of what? Market values of the shares of the companies involved in the transaction. So, in my example, I've been using company A and company B. Let's assume company A and company B, they are listed. So, it means you can get their market values. So you can use those market values to determine the exchange ratio, which will be equal to the market price of the target company divided by the market price of the acquiring company. Then you get our exchange ratio. So the next one is, in that exchange ratio, how do we adjust for synergic benefits? So if there are any synergic benefits expected, the takeover price will often be at a mean premium to the market price. So mathematically, how do you take into account synergic benefits in calculating the exchange ratio? So we play around with our formula which to determine the market premium. We are now saying the market price of the acquiring company times the exchange ratio divided by the market price of the target company minus 1. And then we get the market premium that can then be added to the exchange ratio. Now, still moving on with our price earnings ratio. So remember, I said one of the things in a share exchange transaction is post the exchange, neither shareholder wants a dilution in their earnings per share. So if a takeover is financed with a share exchange, the key question is what will be the post merger price earnings ratio? So if you look at price earnings, the price normally is determined by the market forces. And then the earnings is measured how they pay. Market actually performed. So normally that's why people say the PE is a function of investor perceptions on how the merger will impact on future growth and risk. So you can find that post the merger, the price can actually go up, not because earnings have gone, But it's just because investors perceive that this combined entity is going to achieve greater growth. So, however, if we say we assume that there's going to be little change in perceptions post the merger, then the PE ratio can be estimated as a weighted average of the current PE ratio of the two companies. Example, company A, pre-merger PE ratio is 15, earnings 100. Company B, pre-merger PE ratio 12, earnings 50 million. So the weighted PE post-merger can be calculated as a function of the pre-merger PE ratios, which would give us a PE ratio of 40. So find that this one is more of a theoretical post-merger PE ratio. Why? Because in practice, the market definitely, their perceptions will change post-merger. Say, okay, what value do we put on this post-merger entity? Now, looking again at from the target company's shareholders, what would increase their value? So synergic benefits would definitely increase the value of the combined firm as compared to the value of the individual firms. So the question is, who gets this major benefit? So there are two possibilities. Say either the value goes to the company shareholders or the value goes to the buying company shareholders. So if the value is going to go to the target company shareholders, it then brings us again to say what is the maximum price that the target shareholders should pay? So the acquiring shareholders should pay to the target company shareholders, which then talks to the exchange ratio from the perspective of the target company. And again, with another formula. So what is that? The figure, the exchange ratio we get from that formula, what does it tell us? We are getting the maximum exchange rate that the acquiring company can offer without affecting its own value. So the first formula, what the maximum exchange ratio that the acquiring company can offer without affecting its PE ratio. In this one, we are not saying the exchange ratio, we are determining to use market values. But post acquisition, I don't want my value to be eroded. So what is the maximum value as the companies, as the shareholder company A, that we should offer to shareholder company B? Which post-merger will not have an impact to our own value. So you need to be very careful in the examiner to say, have you really understood what you are required to do? And therefore, which formula should you be applying? Then on the flip side, if the acquiring company is the one obtaining all the increase in value, then expected ratio would be. Here we are not saying I'm the target company or we are the sellers. We are saying if we get this exchange ratio, post the transaction, I don't want to be worse off. I don't want any erosion in value. To say pre-merger, maybe I was better off versus post-merger as a shareholder in the selling company. So to ensure that there's no loss in value to the selling shareholder, we can then apply this formula to determine the expected ratio. So we are saying this is not the minimum ratio that the target company shareholders can obtain without losing value. So I want to really emphasize on these four formulas that I've shared to date. The first two were around erosion of the price earnings ratio. These two, the last two, are now around the erosion of the market values. So on which formula to apply in the examination, you need to be very clear what is the required instructed you to do. Okay, so this is just a simple example which is now calculating the post-merger PE ratio using the weightings. It was an example around the maximum exchange ratio taking into account synergic benefits and the minimum exchange ratios. Now we want to look at other factors that may have an impact on exchange ratios. So far we've looked at the price earnings ratio, the market values of the combined entities. So dividends can also affect the exchange ratio. To say, example, company A and company B pay $2 in dividends per share, but are priced at $40 and $30 respectively. An exchange ratio based on market values, that is 0.75, will result in a dividend per share in the dilution of dividend per share of Company B from $2 to $1.50. And Company B shareholders will not be happy about that. So it means the exchange ratio should then take cognizance of this possible issue. And then also, working capital can also affect exchange ratio. If I'm a shareholder in a company which is cash rich, I would want to continue enjoying that because why? It may mean that either my investment is going to be able to buy, is good access to cheap capital, and also there's a higher chance of getting dividend income. And all these things would then also have an impact on the exchange ratio. Net asset value, which companies with a higher net asset value, post the acquisition, they might not lose anything as far as net asset value per share is concerned. So maybe require the same discuss other factors to consider in determining the exchange ratio. These are some of the factors you can refer to. Then also, like we said, mergers will definitely result in a possible change in the net asset value. So we're now going to be going to part three of this lecture recording, where we'll further elaborate on issues around mergers and acquisition. So please do make sure you take time to go to part three of this lecture series on mergers and acquisition. Thank you very much for taking time to watch this lecture.